Good evening. Thank you for having me tonight. It's an honor and a privilege to be talking with you guys tonight. And I hope you will enjoy this presentation I will be giving. I actually gave this presentation a couple years ago and didn't think much many people would come, and suddenly the pilot does a huge full-page advert and article about the presentation, and suddenly Pretlow Library, which has its program room, what, about 150 people? The whole, that poor library had about at least 200 people show up and just were fighting out in the hallways just trying to get in to look at this presentation. So thank you, and let's get going with this wonderful presentation. So this presentation basically is about Norfolk's, the men behind the photographs that we see in our restaurants. We see them in our books, anywhere and everywhere. It seems like these pictures keep popping up, and I wanted to at least tell the story about the men that actually took these photographs, and so people can be better aware of them. To start off with, Norfolk history. Norfolk actually has, in terms of other cities, not as great of a visual and illustrative drawings of the city, especially in the early 1800s. It's amazing, sometimes people come in, I want to know what Norfolk looked like in early 1800s. Well, unfortunately, there's not that many images and drawings for Norfolk. Of course, we have some pencil sketches and early watercolors of parts of Norfolk, but there's really not a good overview of the city. Of course, photography in itself, of course, first one, the daguerreotypes, as well as here in Norfolk, we actually had a photographer in 1855 set up a shop here on Main Street and was advertising, come in, have your photograph taken. And of course, as you recognize from the bookmark, this is Admiral Martinique sketches of the western part of downtown Norfolk, or what is now downtown Norfolk, but you have the stone covered bridge for Granby Street, and then everything around on the west side is more of the Town Point Park area. So this is probably one of the early drawings of Norfolk. This is a sketch of the Virginia Bank building in Moses Myers' watercolors. They did a watercolor set of all of a lot of his properties, and this is one of them. And of course, as you talk about the daguerreotypes, this is probably a prime example of one. Thomas Jenkins Roberts, who was later the first president of Liberia and also a Norfolk native. This actually, the Library of Congress has this scanned. And then also saying, here's one of the advertisements from 1855 of Thomas Jenkins here on Main Street, selling and asking people to come get your pictures taken. So this is about 5-6 years before the war. A lot of times when you start looking for images of Norfolk around the mid-1800s, you have the lithographs from like the Harper's Weekly and Frank Leslie's newspapers and periodicals. And this is one of Norfolk Harbor about 1856. And then, of course, as you start getting into the Civil War, this is probably one of the more famous shots of Norfolk, scenes of Norfolk during the capture by Union forces, May 1862. This is probably the first and only known image, earliest known image of Norfolk in 1862, 63, 64. We kind of think it's more of 1865, but at least this is probably the earliest shot of Norfolk, photograph-wise, of the landscape. Down towards the bottom of the photograph, you have what we think is Union soldiers marching up Bank Street, and the house and where we are standing today is basically up near the chimney on the right-hand side. So this is Bank Street looking north from about Main Street. And then as you start getting into the late 1800s, you start having some more bird's eye view of the city from what they consider as if they're in a balloon looking down on the city. There's at least three shots, one from 1872, 73. There's one from the 1890 and 1891. A lot of times you'll see replicated and up in areas around Norfolk. But as after the war, we have a lot of the commercial photographers coming in and actually start doing carte de visite photographs here in Norfolk. We probably have about 5 to 7 of them active during the during that time here in Norfolk. Kind of like the Richmond Art Gallery, the Clark at the National, I think it's National Photograph Gallery, and Faber is also another one that shows up. But you can definitely tell through the city directories by looking at these carte de visite and their addresses shown that you can basically almost get down to the year or year range that for these images. So a lot of them that I've come across in our photograph collection tends to be about the 1880s, 1890s, and turn of the century. But tonight, of course, as Peggy was saying, these are our four major photographers that have been here documenting life in Norfolk. I'm sure people definitely recognize quite a bit of a few of these names, or maybe even all of them. But I would probably say, in terms of completeness and the amount of photographs, images that has been kept together, these four gentlemen probably are definitely the major photographers for this area. And we'll start with the first one, Harry C. Mann. I know sometimes when I start talking to people and I say, well, Harry Mann took that photo, I know it gets that crazy Harry Mann, and then they realize, oh, it's Harry. So, but Harry was actually from Petersburg. He's member of the famous Mann family here in Virginia that had a big play in our politics and governance. He's the son of Judge Edward and Patty Mann. There's a little bit, I would almost say, Harry got into photography late in life. During his early, say, 20s and 30s, he's clerking at the state senate. He's also like a drugstore clerk, doing some odd jobs and everything. And then finally, around 1907, during the Jamestown Exposition, his brother James Mann, of course, who would later become Judge Mann here in Norfolk, prominent attorney, got him a job at the expo with the photographic department. And that's basically where he starts learning the trade for being a photographer. And it seems that he took it to heart and he found his niche in life, because I would probably say he's probably one of the most artistic of our photographers here. Nationally and internationally recognized for his work. He did series of nature scenes around Cape Henry and Prince's Anne County in that area. Published even in the National Geographic. He had photographs shown in London and Paris. So it's just amazing the quality of his work. After all that moving around Petersburg and Richmond and here for the Jamestown Expo, he actually settles here in Norfolk, I believe in Algonquin Park with his brother, and actually lives basically the rest of his life here in Norfolk, especially his professional career here. He started about 1908, 1909, and kept going until his health started failing in 1924. He later died up in Lynchburg and then is buried with the rest of the family. But kind of like as you see right here, this is the Smith & Welton building there on Granby Street. This is one of his nature scenes there at the Cape Henry. This is President Taft visiting Norfolk. This is Granby Street at Brook Avenue about 1909. He paid a visit here. And of course, a lot of our Largemont residents, I know you guys go nuts over this photo because it shows an early view of Largemont. And this is probably about a 1914 aerial of Largemont. Some may recognize where it is and some know, but if you do recognize, we have the, it's actually the trolley tracks along Hampton Boulevard, and where the Largemont billboard sign is, that sits between Manchester and Hanover. And then on the right-hand side where this street starts curving, that's Jamestown Crescent. Harry also did a lot of shots of businesses inside and outside, almost a day in a life. This is actually Burke and Gregory, which is one of our printers, major printers here in the area. This is about January of 1912. And this is inside their factory there on basically where City Hall is now, where the Circuit Court, actually now the old Circuit Court building is, where St. Paul's and Main Street run into each other. Of course, this is not too far down a couple blocks from here, but this is the foundation for the Royster Building. They're doing the pilings for the building, June 10th, 1912. He did a series, probably about 6 to 7 pictures of them piling, putting the piles in for the building. And what's interesting to note is a couple weeks ago, the Norfolk Redevelopment and Housing Authority actually donated their blueprints, original blueprints for the Royster Building. And we have the blueprints that has the color-coded pilings for this, for that building. So you've probably seen this in Carol Walker's book, Commercial Place. He's probably looking from his studio on Main Street, looking southeast onto Commercial Place. And of course, another aerial shot, panoramic shot from Berkeley, looking towards Norfolk. There's at least 54, 55 surviving panoramic negatives. They are the same size as the panoramic prints that you see sometimes in the antique shops. They are actually that size. And thanks with our partnership with the Library of Virginia, they were kind enough to scan these panoramas that we have of Harry C. Mann. And this is why we have a digital copy now. Twin City Motorcycle Club, we actually were able to date some of these prints. And this one's from about 1913, 1914. And I know it may be hard to see, but there's actually a white line underneath the bike tires. And he actually, he knew his craft in that he was able to set up the shot to make it sure that it looked great as a photograph. Because you've got to remember, too, is that back then he's using glass plates. He's also using probably very expensive film sheets. So he has to take it in one shot or two shots. He can't simply just do it, take five shots and pick the best of the five. If you see a lot of the postcards, if you collect a lot of the postcards, a lot of the postcards from the 1910s, 1920s, those are actually colorized versions of his photographs. He's very prolific in their just amazing how many photographs actually got turned into postcards. This is one of a gentleman roasting oysters there at Cape Henry. So there's actually the negative, the glass negative that he actually took of that, and then the colorized postcard. Some of the aerial shots that he took for the shot of Ghent, he actually had two separate photographs and then merged them into one aerial shot. So this is the age before Photoshop and photo merge. So you got to give him kudos. He knows his craft when he can seamlessly merge the two images together. This is just a rough draft of it. And then, of course, for the library, we have our own post office, shot of our own post office about 1909. And, of course, he was active, of course, during the war, World War I, so we have shots of World War I here in Norfolk. This is tug of war going on with some Navy sailors at the Hermitage. And then a bond rally right there at the footsteps of the custom house. Of course, he's out on one of the destroyers doing depth charges. Borges is probably one of our other, I would probably say, master photographers for this area. The quality of his work is just phenomenal. We get to scan and work with his negatives almost every day, and it's just amazing. Every time you open up a packet that you just don't know what you're going to find, but you know you're going to get a great image. Charlie, as he liked to be known, was born here in Brambleton, which, if you don't remember where Brambleton, now it's, of course, Norfolk State area. He was born there to Charles and Greta Gertrude Borges. His father was a composer, a classical music composer, and he went through public school here in Norfolk. He also was a natural-born athlete, and he actually tried out for some of the semi-professional baseball team out in like Bristol and made the team. But when he came back home, he had an elevator accident that crushed his foot. So any dreams of becoming like a professional sports athlete went down the tubes. And what he did in the meantime is he developed an interest in photography and actually started reading up on the subject. The family went to the stores, bought all the books they could find. He actually went to the public library and learned the trade from Norfolk Public Library. So we can say that we did have an effect on him. So, and of course, he started taking up photography about 1913 when he joined the Virginian Pilot. He did do a stint with the Norfolk Artillery Blues and went out to the Mexican border for 2 years. And then came back and started working for the pilot and retired after 43 years. But during his time, he actually himself received a lot of national and international praise and recognition for his work, especially like the Roma crash and the Berkeley fire, the big Berkeley fire. He did retire from the pilot in 1956 and then passed 3 days, 3 years later, and is buried with the rest of the family in Elmwood. But he was actually the first full-time photographer for the pilot. Said to be that he is very proud of being able to photograph every president from President Wilson to President Eisenhower. He was able to get a shot of every president who visited Norfolk. He also, with his friend H.D. Vollmer, did a lot of helped with the Norfolk Photographic Club. He was active with that and helped trained. And there's also stories of him taking shots, one shot at least, of on assignment where he had to take a photograph, a great photograph of the Corps Mausoleum there in Elmwood. And he waited almost to the last moment to do it. So he gets there Saturday night. It's due Sunday. And so it's around dinner time. He's like, light's fading. He needs to get a great shot. So he puts a little bit extra flash in the flash pan. Well, if you know of Elmwood, a lot of the neighborhood off of Church Street butts up right against the Elmwood Cemetery, and where the Corps Mausoleum is, it's real close to the wall. on the east side. And so it's he can hear everybody in the neighborhood. They're just enjoying themselves. And suddenly he goes and takes the photograph. Blam. It's almost like Hiroshima is going off. It scares the dickens out of all the neighbors around the mausoleum. And so he quickly grabs all his stuff, runs back to the paper, develops the image, gets it into paper. And he starts scratching his head later. Well, what happened with the people? Did they all come back? So he goes back the next morning, probably about midday, and not a single soul within a couple blocks of that where he took the photographs. He scared them so bad with the flash. And of course, his adventures being a photographer for the paper continued. He was covering one of the warehouse fires and was on one of the roofs of the adjacent building. And he sets up his equipment and takes a shot. Well, the fire department thinks that the embers flew over onto the building that he was on. So they turned their hoses onto the roof where he was. And luckily he got close enough, out of the way a bit, that he only got knocked down by the water, but he got real lucky that he didn't get blown off by water off the roof. So he did have some interesting adventures working for the newspaper. But let's take a look at some of the images he took. This is actually one of his early shots of the Roma crash, the Army base, training base, right there now that's NIT. So this is February of 1922. And then, and of course, a couple months later, he covered the Berkeley fire. So we have about 15 images of the Berkeley fire. This is one of them. The fire was completely devastating. It just knocked at least 20 to 30 blocks, just leveled. Of course, some of our early aviation pictures he took. This is about 1930. Francis Stobbs and Dave Dishill learning how to use one of the flyers. And of course, you may recognize this building to some extent. This was the Texaco building, but it is now that strip mall right there at Onley and Bush Street. So this is about, say, about 1922-24. The Ford plant was one of his big stops that he would go to. He was there for the first truck to come, vehicle come off the line. And then later on in the 50s, so this is 1925. And then in 1953, he's back on the assembly line inside the plant. Of course, you may have gone to this school, but here's Largemont Elementary, about 1930. And then, of course, here's another shot of Commercial Place, July of 1924. Ships, planes, buildings, military. This is one of the brand names for the Old Dominion line, the George Washington. She had a sister ship, the Robert E. Lee, but he took this in 1925. And then during the hurricane of 1933, the big one, he took quite a few pictures of the devastation that wrecked the area. So this is one of the cottages at Ocean View. And then, of course, I'm sure everybody has seen this image, flooding right there on Granby Street, probably getting close to Brook Avenue and City Hall Avenue. We actually had somebody come in and say, well, that's my grandfather, Officer Mayo. Standing in the picture. He didn't, with the cameras that he was using, sometimes he didn't have the equipment that will allow him to do aerial shots or panoramic shots, but to give you an idea of his artistic ability, he took three shots of the Bainfield baseball field right there on 20th and Church Street. And in the newspaper, he actually merged all three images and was in the newspaper. This is actually a modern merge. I use Photoshop on this one, but it didn't require any major movement or skewing of the image to make it fit. This gentleman was truly an artist as a photographer. Sometimes even the funny, it's so hot, you can cook an egg. You can cook an egg on a street. And believe it or not, this is actually down the street from us on Plume Street. She's cooking an egg. It was actually 101 temperature on that day. This is 1936. And then, of course, when the city took over the post office, it became City Hall. And so he actually has some pictures of the city moving into the building and would take pictures through the years. This is actually a shot from 1938, right when it becomes City Hall. Parades were, of course, another big, I can't tell you how many packets of parade pictures we have. And usually there's at least 20 shots per packet. So at least I know he loved to do parades, he loved to do the Navy ships, he loved to do baseball and sports. What he hated to do, along with Vollmer, was the debutantes. They absolutely despised doing the debutante parties and celebrations. And he could always find amusement even in the craziest of situations. So this is July of 1939, and it's the flooded Redgate Avenue right there at Stockley Garden. So the ladies, it rained 5 inches in 30 and 90 minutes. And for the history buffs, he actually took quite a few pictures of all the major battleships that were stationed here in Norfolk from the 30s and the 40s. So this is like the battleship was West Virginia in the harbor. And of course, if most of these battleships were sunk or damaged, severely damaged at Pearl Harbor. So you can almost see before and after pictures with the collection. I would almost say this is probably a prime example of his artistic ability as a photographer. This probably makes him a master photographer. If you can't see it, this is Bill Skiff, who's the manager of the Norfolk Tars, about ready to hit a baseball. And so, to make it easier for you. So considering that he took this about 1932 and 33 with a one-shot camera, basically, he was able to grab this image. And then, of course, active very much during the World War II. So a lot of our history, visual history of Norfolk during the war can be seen. Another shot of them tearing apart, scrapping the airplanes, naval airplanes there at the base. And then, of course, a lot of our community, this is the East Ocean View Fire Department, the gentleman, and then, of course, the ladies. You get, he was kind enough, the supporters, the auxiliary. These were taken in 1953. And then finally, I would probably say his famous shots of Granby Street, taken in July of 1941. They actually reused this in December to show the difference between what Norfolk was 6 months earlier and then what Norfolk was like during the blackout. So she probably noticed the Norva and the Lowe's Theater marquees and everything. His partner and companion as rival newspaper, but as the Norfolk Ledger Dispatch was purchased by Landmark Publication, Landmark, that they actually came under the same umbrella, but they still kept the two newspapers going and they kept the two photography departments going as well. So Vollmer would do the afternoon shift and Borges would do the morning shift. So Vollmer is actually a native of Richmond. He actually lived in Richmond much of his early life before moving down here in Norfolk. He attended most of his grade school here in Norfolk and actually developed a lifelong interest in art and the different mediums. I would probably say his interest started, especially when he was joined the Army photography department with the Army Signal Corps during World War I. That's where he learned to trade and then came back and kept working for the Norfolk Ledger Dispatch more as a photographer. But he's also known too for his different mediums, etchings, pastels. This is one of his linoleum block printing. So even after he retired, he kept taking photographs. His daughter, Claire, actually donated quite a bit of his collection to us. So we have not only his personal collection, but also his professional collection at the library. So another couple of shots of him at work, one of the type cameras he used. And this is in 1939, they did a, how does the newspaper get produced? And they showed scenes of the photography department as well as them getting the plate sets together for the newspaper printing. Like Borges, he had a great affinity for sports. So there's a lot of baseball pitchers. There's a lot of pitchers of football, high school, as well as communal teams. Even he was here when Babe Ruth popped in, when the Norfolk Tars was part of the New York Yankees farm team system. The famous game in 1934 when the Yankees came down and all the big players, famous players with the Yankees came down, Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, they all came down for the game. And this is actually a shot right there on the Washington steamer docks. He actually stopped and got his photo taken with the kids. Some other shots of Ocean View, the boats there at Ocean View Amusement Park, 4th of July, 1938. Then you have some other shots of one of the tugboats going underneath the Berkeley Bridge. Sometimes he got some crazy shots. Mr. Smith was flying around and he actually had some trouble. And poor Miss Christopoulos Cottage there in Chesapeake Beach was a poor victim of not so great landing. She was actually in the house at the time. Thankfully, nobody was on the second floor. And Mr. Smith, who's in the upper left-hand corner, basically just escaped with a little gash on his cheek. So he got very lucky. Even some of the notables that came in, actress Margaret Sullivan visits Norfolk, in 1938. During his time too with the paper, he also documented Norfolk's role as a part in international affairs. This is actually, it doesn't look like much, but this is actually a photograph of Chinese nationalists boarding a couple of our steamers in order to use them as blockade runners against Japan. They came all the way from San Francisco by train. They got off and the crews took three of this the freighters here in Norfolk and would ship them, drive them all the way back to Shanghai, China. From what I can tell, it looks like all three ships made it, at least for that trip, because these ships show up in the registers for merchant vessels. So some of the guns there at Fort Story, 1941, you may have seen this image in some of the history books. This is Battery A, and the Coastal Artillery Regiment. having some target practice. He also documented the German POWs there in Thaya, in Princess Anne County. So almost where the central library there is in Virginia Beach, that's where the POW camp was. And then he was there when FDR died. So he went out on the street. They actually did a couple late version editions of the Ledger Dispatch. And then when quieter times is that he's there at Harrison Fishing Pier right on opening day. So this was August 6, 1947. And then finally, our last character, Carol Walker. I'm sure a lot of you would recognize his name. He's actually not, as much as he loved Norfolk, he was not a native. He was actually from Baltimore. But he was raised here in Bramlington and attended Norfolk schools. During his youth, his father died and actually was left to help raise his mother and the rest of his siblings. He was actually wanted to become a professional painter, but right as he was going to school, about ready to start school, the Great Depression hit and he wasn't able to go to school. So he then joined Norfolk Western and works for the railroad for a good 38 years. So now that he has a steady job, he starts devoting his creative energies and taking photographs, and also, as well as Norfolk history. I know for some of the photographers, he's a bit different in terms of not only did he collected photographs of early Norfolk history, but he also took photographs. He was more of a he documented Norfolk's Renaissance, especially during the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And then a lot of our early shots, getting Harry C. Mann images back in the local conscience and whatnot. He did do two books. I'm sure a lot of us probably have the one or both copies in our on our bookcases. He did one on Norfolk, a pictorial history in 1975. And then he did another one for the tricentennial in 1981. At the time of his death, he was actually was being pestered by his book publisher to create a third book. And his children were saying when they were getting ready to clean out the house, they found some clotheslines in the house where he had pictures starting to be chosen, I guess, for his third book. So, so he thought, as much as he wanted to preserve Norfolk history and it's especially its photographic history, he planned for the future and actually donated his collection to the Norfolk Public Library, so to the Sargent Memorial Collection, so everybody can enjoy the photographs. Here are some of the early images that he was able to collect. This was the Reina Mercedes, one of the Spanish naval vessels sunk at the Battle of Santiago in Cuba. It was raised a few years later and brought back to Norfolk as a war prize. This is actually here at the Norfolk Naval Shipyard, 1901. Shot, an early shot of City Hall Avenue at Granby Street. You can tell the Monticello Hotel on the left and the Haddington Building on the right. He was able to pick up a lot of these glass negatives. This is one of them of Cape Henry, probably from the 20s. Some other shots of Ocean View during the 1910s, 20s. I found this image actually as a small little negative in his collection, and this is from 1912, looking up Granby Street from roughly Plume Street and City Hall. One of the great little caches that he found and was able to hang on to was the Curtis Flying Field School there in Newport News, and there's about 12 glass plate negatives of these different airplanes at the school. And of course, everything old is new again. This is actually one of the early electric cars here in Norfolk, but it's also has one of the suffragettes in the car, probably at one of the parades. And then, as I was saying, he also documented Norfolk's transformation in the 60s. So here's kind of like downtown being renovated and redone to more of what we see today. So about 1965, decided the Virginia National Bank, or now Bank of America. Some other shots. So he provides a very important link in our photographic history of the 70s and the 80s and the 90s when he was taking photographs. So Main Street, about 1982, almost close to where we are now. And then, of course, Norfolk Southern being built. And I must say the man had an affinity for ships. I can't tell you how many ship pictures we have in his collection. He absolutely loved going to Harbor Fest and when the tall ships came in, taking photographs upon photographs of the tall ships and everything that came through. So this is the Simon Boulevard there in 1989. And then, of course, sometimes as you go through their collections, especially Carol's, you see your friends and neighbors and coworkers. I don't know if you recognize, but one of our historical society members, but Carter Furr is actually in the one on the image on the left. He's the gentleman in the middle, looking with his hand on the pinball machine. I showed him this image once, and I said, you definitely haven't changed much in 50 years. Maybe the hair has gone a little gray on you, but other than that, you haven't changed much. And then, of course, our lovable George Tucker and his wife, Elizabeth. So, and then I will say that there is a couple places where you can actually go online and actually see a lot of these images go up and appreciate their hard work and the types of photographs that they've taken through the years. The Norfolk Public Library, through the Sergeant Memorial Collection, has a new digital gallery for these images. You can get them right off the library's website. And then the Library of Virginia has actually scanned 2,700 images of the Harry C. Mann collection and has put it up online as well. So you can see basically all of these gentlemen's samples of their works, or in some cases, all of their works. So I will say too that there's about 7,000 images on the library's website. There's about 27,000 on the Library of Virginia, but with the library, there's actually about 100,000 images collectively from Carol Walker and Charles Borges, as well as H.D. Vollmer, along with a few other of the of their co-workers at the papers. But the majority of their images are either at the library or at the Library of Virginia. So this is just a sampling of what they were able to do. So I do wish and thank you very much for having me tonight. And please, if you have any questions, I'll be glad to take them. As well, if later you want to be able to look at the images, you can come by the library or you can go by our website and take a look. So thank you.